I would like to give the floor now to the man who made this all possible, who invited all the speakers, who is at the heart of learning histories in the Netherlands himself. That's Rick Peters, my esteemed dear colleague, close colleague at the university here. Rick is associate professor at the Department of History here, and in 2004, so 12 years ago, he started the course Learning Histories and Organizations with Frank Ankersmit, who is present. Oh, he's there. Yeah, Frank. he has supervised dozens of action research learning histories over the years, and I'm happy to have joined his team a few years ago, and I really enjoy every day. I enjoy the practice of working with students who are doing learning histories. Rick, the floor is yours.
Okay. Let me check. Yep. Ladies and gentlemen, to this moment we have all been looking forward. In the past 25 years, learning histories have grown into an internationally acknowledged theory and method of organizational change and learning. But in spite of this, no special conference has been organized on learning histories. For quite some time, therefore, many of us felt a strong need to come together and to exchange our experience and ideas. But with all the recent breaking news, this feeling turned into a sense of urgency, for it's crystal clear that events like the financial crisis, the Brexit, the crumbling down of the EU, the elections in the US and in Europe, the refugee crisis, and the increasing tension in international affairs, not to mention global warming and pollution, put an enormous pressure on our societies and their people. Indeed, for the first time since the Second World War, we really have to worry that the very sustainability of our societies is at stake. And in this conference, we approach the problem of the sustainability of society from the perspective of organizations. Given their key role in our societies, organizations deeply feel the pressure of the recent developments. Indeed, many of the crises which now torment our world are directly related to a breakdown of organizations. Think of banks, failing control institutions, or if you wish, the World Football Association. For that reason, we need to create sustainable societies to keep our society sustainable. That's the key idea of this conference, if not the ideal of this conference. To be sure, learning histories are not the only method to make organizations more sustainable, but they are important, and I would say increasingly more important. Big problems have long histories. So truly sustainable solutions for organizational problems cannot be found in quick fixes, but only in thorough analysis of their histories. That's the main idea of this conference. The relevance of this idea is shown by the fact that so many of you were immediately willing to contribute, and that so many people registered as participants. So let me first thank all the speakers who have traveled enormous distances to be here today and tomorrow. Together with the audience, I look forward to listening to your papers and presentations. Secondly, I would like to thank all the people in the audience who have come here. It's with you that we like to share and discuss our ideas. Thirdly, I thank the institutions which funded this conference, the ICOG and the Groningen University Fund, and special thanks also for the audiovisual department of the Faculty of Arts, who will be registering the complete conference and make it available on the internet. Above all, I thank Sharon Smith, Director of Sustainable Society, who not only most generously helped funding this conference, but also lent her best organizers, Kina, Martijn, and Jaline. Really, without your help, this conference would not have been possible. And finally, I thank our moderator, my dear colleague, Dirk-Jan Wolfram, who will guide us through these days. Ladies and gentlemen, let's give them a warm applause. Well, as you have seen, the title of my paper is Learning Histories, a short history of their theory and practice. And short it will be, because Dirk-Jan is very strict on the schedule. My sole aim is to offer a platform for our discussions today and tomorrow, and I hope in the future. In order to stimulate these discussions, my paper will, of course, have the form of learning history. I will focus more on the questions that face learning historians than on the answers they have found. And I will begin with a short history of learning histories. So I will begin with a short history, and then I will proceed to the most fundamental problems we have to deal with. And finally, I will conclude with a view of the future for learning histories. But let's start at the beginning. When was the idea of learning histories born? Well, if you take the notion of learning histories in a very broad sense, it is as old as the historical discipline. For in fact, Greek historians like Herodotus and Thucydides were writing histories in order to learn for the future. And so did the Chinese historian Sima Qian in the first century before Christ. And Roman rhetoricians like Cicero and later humanists like Valla and Vico held that historia magistra vitae. And interestingly, they held that history as the teacher of life is the precondition for social stability, or if you wish, sustainability. So from a historical point of view, there is nothing new under the sun with learning histories. But when we take the notion of learning histories in a strict sense, we will have to begin around 1994, though the exact birth date of the method is shrouded in mythical clouds. What we get from the evidence is that learning histories were developed at MIT Boston in the context of the theory of learning organizations. More specifically, it seems that learning histories were deliberately developed as one of the tools for organizational learning. Fortunately, we can check this account today or tomorrow, because George Roth, here he is, and Art Kleiner, next to him, and Hilary Bradbury are all here in Groningen, and we are very happy with that. From the beginning, learning histories were seen as a new form of research and intervention. Of course, there had been many business histories around, and the notion of learning organizations had also been planted. But the idea of explicitly using histories as a means to organizational learning was quite new, and to some even shocking, as we can see from the first comments. Moreover, it seems that the first learning histories were quite effective, though we do not have clear evidence for this. Between 1994 and 1997, learning histories were written for several companies in the US, but only two were published, Kyle Lorange and Oil Change, both written by Art Kleiner and George Roth. From the US, learning histories spread over the world. How exactly is difficult to say, because few of them have actually been published. Apparently, learning historians, like most action researchers, are more interested in getting research done than in getting it published. But they certainly are very active. In my preparations for this conference, I found dozens of references to learning histories written for organizations in Italy, Spain, France, Switzerland, England, Germany, and Austria. And I'm very happy that some colleagues from those countries will speak today and tomorrow. Margaret Geertie from England, Karin Thien, Christine Erler from Germany, and Thomas Kurz from Austria. And through Hilary Bradbury's Action Research Network, the method of learning histories has been disseminated to many other countries. And I'm happy that Gülen Hashmi from Turkey and Shamaila Gül from Pakistan registered for this conference. And Shamaila will also write a report on the conference for the website of Action Research, which will be available in due time. Finally, as you may have noticed, learning histories also found their way to the Netherlands. And in the audience, I see some Dutch learning historians of the first hour, like Floor Basten and Mark Koenders. Thank you for coming here. My own first encounter with learning histories took place in 2002. I had just got my PhD in philosophy and founded my own consultancy, which I called Q&A. In 2002, I was working as a trainer and a consultant in a water district in the south of Holland. As you may guess from all the water that surrounds us here, water districts are very important in Holland. In fact, they are the oldest democratic institution of our country, going back to the Middle Ages, and they still play a vital role in our eternal fight against the water. But in 2002, I was not hired to write a history of the water district, but to modernize its management. And in that context, I gave individual coaching for managers and team leaders, and at regular times we held Socratic dialogues with the entire staff. And on one day, I vividly remember, I was training some veteran team leaders on coaching methods when suddenly one said to me, "Rick, it's all okay with your fancy ideas, but never forget that only 25 years ago, our boss paid us every month in cash outside on the dikes from a little leather bag." Well, that remark hit me like a hammer, because all of a sudden I realized that I was working in an organization with a long past that was still living on in the present. Shortly after this, I read The Dance of Change for my dialogue sessions, and then I saw the term learning histories for the first time. The pages of my copy are still full of exclamation marks, because when I read about learning histories, all things came together. I had already started to write out the results of the coaching sessions as input for the dialogues, but now I saw that I could use both of them in a learning history that could help the water district to transform itself. And so I did. With that experience, I came to Groningen in 2003. And at that time, Professor Frank Ankerschmidt, here present, had just begun a course for the new Master History today, which trains historians for all kinds of jobs in society. Frank invited me to participate in his course, in which we studied the use of history in government evaluations, parliamentary inquiries, and commissioned historical research, like the Srebrenica report. It was during that course that one of our students, Adrian van Veldhuis, also present here, asked, "Why don't we write those evaluations ourselves?" And at that moment, all dots connected. Frank and I assigned Adrian to write a learning history about political troubles in a municipality somewhere in the west of Holland, not here. In this way, learning histories landed in Groningen. And since then, Peter Senge's Fifth Discipline and George Roth's and Art Kleiner's Car Launch and Oil Change have been obligatory reading. And to these books, we later added the articles in the SAGE Handbooks of Action Research, edited by Hilary Bradbury. And all this we merged with our own theories of history, about which I will tell more at the end of my paper. Since 2004, more than 65 short learning histories have been written here for schools, hospitals, elderly care institutions, municipalities, departments, administrations, political parties, lower house commissions, corporations like Ethos, the Royal Dutch Telephone Company KPN, or Dina and Philips. Many of these researches led to master theses, and some of them to national or international publications. In the course of time, the projects also began to grow. For example, in 2007, we did research in several departments of the Dutch Employment Service, which resulted in a learning history for the entire organization of 30,000 employees. In 2010, we started a learning history for tax inspectors, which became a big project stretching over several years and covering several departments of the Dutch tax administration. In 2012, we presented results for the Ministry of Finance. Finally, in 2014, we started a learning history for the municipality of our own beloved city, Groningen, about which we'll hear much more tomorrow. Learning historians learn from practice, and so did we. For us, that was an interesting experience because we are historians specialized in the theory of history. As such, we have been trained in interpreting documents from distant pasts and in deciphering philosophical text, but not in applying theory to practice. To put ideas to practice was also a very rewarding experience for us, and especially for our students, because by writing learning histories for organizations, they began to realize that historians can make a difference in society. Moreover, it soon became clear that experience with learning histories may help our students to find jobs. Accordingly, the motto of our course, this is actually the first slide in the course, is there is nothing more practical than good history. It's a slightly changed citation. We have to be honest as historians. Now, what did we learn in the past 13 years? And here I come to the second part of my talk. Obviously, 30 minutes is not enough to discuss all of it. And I could say many interesting things about how we discovered how to approach organizations and how to translate organizations' problems into feasible research questions. I can also explain how we gradually developed our interview techniques from quite straightforward questioning to the complex method of circular questioning, which we adopted from psychologists. And I can also tell you many things about the presentations we have held for organizations and their response to our findings. But I will restrict myself to mentioning that we have had all kinds of reactions from the very negative to the very positive. Sometimes our learning histories were flatly dismissed, but more often they were well received. And one organization speaks for all of them when it said in a typical Dutch way, "Thank you very much for your kicks in our asses." All that is very interesting, but that will take too much time. Instead, I will concentrate on the most important problem we had to deal with in the past 13 years. In my view, this is not only the most difficult problem of learning histories, but also the most fundamental problem, because sooner or later, all learning historians have to deal with it. Now, what is this problem? Its kernel lies in the very notion of learning histories, that is, the claim that organizations can effectively learn something from their past. Perhaps many of you find no difficulty in this, but for us, it was extremely hard to explain. To understand that, you must realize that we are working in a history department. As you may discover these days, historians are very, very friendly people, but they are also highly critical. Moreover, they are outright suspicious about the idea that something can be learned from history. Once you claim this, and I warn you, because there are historians here present, historians immediately start quoting authorities like the philosopher Hegel, who famously said that the only thing we can learn from history is that we cannot learn from it. Or they quote the historian Michael Oakeshott, who with typical British phlegm observed, "Those who assert themselves to have learned something from history may have learned what they assert, and it may be true, but they have certainly not learned it from history." And there you go. To make things worse, here at our department, which is renowned for its theory of history, historians are even more critical. Once you claim that it is possible to learn from history, they immediately start asking difficult questions like, "What do you mean by history? Do you mean the past or historical writing? And if you mean the past, about whose past are you talking then? The past of an organization or the pasts, in plural, of the people working in it?" Now, these questions about history are difficult enough, but even more difficult is the second set of questions about the concept of learning. These go like, "What do you mean by learning? Is it reflection? And if so, on what? On the past. And on what in the past? Actions? Events? Processes? And by the way, who is learning from history? Individuals, groups, or entire organizations? And if learning takes place, how would you know? In short, my dear colleague, I don't understand what you mean by learning from history." And this for 13 years. Now, to be sure, these are difficult questions, but they are completely legitimate. and I think that every learning historian must be able to answer them. Fortunately, the first learning historians had already dealt with them. And when we started here in Groningen, we could draw from their answers. To begin with the problems concerning the notion of history. I can be short about that because the learning histories which were available in 2004 meet the scientific standards historians usually adopt. They are serious inquiries about events in the past which are explored on the basis of evidence by methods founded on theoretical principles and expounded in the form of a coherent narrative. Importantly, the first four criteria make sure that that learning histories are not just stories, but indeed histories. That is, they are based on facts. In contrast, the problem of explaining why organizations can learn from their histories is a much bigger problem. In the most general terms, it can be stated as the problem of the relationship between individual and collective learning, which goes back to the relationship between organizations and the individuals working in it, or if you wish, the system and its elements. But I prefer to say that it is the problem of the relationship between systemic and historical thinking, because deep down we are talking about a tension between two approaches to organizational learning. Again, in the most general terms, we can say that systemic thinking is universalizing. It tries to explain the part in terms of the whole, or more specifically, it tries to explain individual learning in the terms of systemic learning. In contrast, historical thinking is individualizing. It tries to explain organizational learning in terms of individual learning, or the whole in terms of the parts. As we see, the tension between the two approaches has deep philosophical roots, and this is why no learning historian can avoid questioning their relationship. The answer to this question conditions all methodological choices, from selecting the evidence to constructing the narrative, and above all, as we soon discovered, to ask the right questions. In the past 25 years, learning historians have addressed these problems many times, and in my view, this history has three phases, as can be seen from the titles of the key publications. If you allow me to schematize, I would say that in the 1990s, when learning history started, systemic thinking prevailed over historical thinking. Next, in the first decade of this century, systemic thinking went undercover, so to speak. And now, since 2010 or 2012, I see a return of the system. You can see it in the titles in red. Let me now outline how learning historians have dealt with the problem of the relationship between systemic and historical thinking. And let me start with the Old Testament of learning histories, Peter Senge's Fifth Discipline. Now, this book is full of shrewd remarks about learning, for example, that it is as necessary to life as sex. And that is always a good starting point for motivating new master students. Moreover, Senge illustrates his theories on organizational learning with dozens of historical examples, from the invention of the airplane to Tolstoy's analysis of battles, to which historians can easily refer. But on closer inspection, history plays only a minor role in Senge's idea of organizational learning. In fact, Senge is quite explicit that learning cannot take place on the level of events, nor on the level of patterns of behavior, but only on the level of systemic structures. It is here that the deep patterns of organizational behavior, the so-called systems archetypes, can be found. According to Senge, it is these archetypes that determine the story of the entire organization, including the stories of the people who are working in it. The crucial connection between the two levels is made by what Senge calls mental models, which he defines in very broad terms as the deeply ingrained assumptions, generalizations, or even pictures and images that influence how we understand the world and how we take action. Crucially, mental models are both individual and collective. That is why they can be explored in team dialogues. The most important mental model individuals must adopt in team learning is the fifth discipline of systemic thinking. In short, systemic thinking is the alpha and omega of organizational learning, and that's why the book is called The Fifth Discipline. To illustrate his theory, Senji offers his famous beer game example, which is very popular among both students and teachers for reasons I need not explain. You all know the story. A retailer, a wholesaler, and a brewer trade beer without communicating directly to each other. At a certain point in time, an increase in demand in beer eventually leads to a total breakdown of the trade cycle, leaving some players with enormous shortages and others with enormous surpluses of beer. With this example, Senji wants to show that the breakdown is completely inexplicable from the standpoint of each of the individual players in the game. As he says, they are prisoners of the system. Therefore, only a structural explanation, that is an explanation which takes the entire system into account, can help the prisoners to escape. The point is now, how can the prisoners know the system? As long as we are playing the beer game, that is not a big problem. After all, the beer game is a simulation, not reality. Accordingly, we know the outcome before the experiment starts. And that is why we know where to find the system, or if you wish, the prison in the game. But historians, and learning historians in particular, are not in the same position. Firstly, they do not set up simulations, but they deal with reality itself. Moreover, they don't have a clue about the archetypes and mental models that determine the thoughts and actions of the individual players. In short, learning historians cannot look down like gods from the systemic Olympus, which you see on the left, to the poor mortals in the beer game, but they have to start deep down in the valley of alcoholic despair, which you see on the right. They have to begin with retailers, wholesalers, and brewers complaining about the chaos in the beer trade and longing for a past in which all things were better. And while listening to all this, learning historians have no clue about the game itself. It is, so to speak, hidden from their sight. For this reason, learning historians always stand for the immense task of developing an idea of the system from an enormous chaotic pile of reports, letters, emails, interviews, etc., before they can ever write a history from which organizations can learn. In short, they have to begin with historical thinking before they can reach the mountaintop of systemic thinking. The first two gospels of learning histories, car launch and oil change, perfectly illustrate this point. Though they are based on systems thinking, they also adopt theories from action science. And in this context, it is interesting to note that Carlange mentions systems thinking only a few times, and that it almost disappears in Oil Change, the second learning history, which is, in my view, more historical than the first. Moreover, unlike Senji, who gave a pretty broad definition of mental models, the first learning histories focus on the basic assumptions underlying the stories of the people working in the organization. These basic assumptions can be retrieved by what they call the ladder of inference, which also forms the basis of the learning histories. Their goal is to expound these basic assumptions in a jointly told story which enhances collective understanding by shared meaning. As you know, the story is told in the right-hand column and the shared meaning is elicited by asking questions in the left-hand column. In this way, learning histories seek to provide an alternative view of organizational learning. In the fifth discipline, systemic thinking is the alpha and omega of learning. In the learning histories, it is historical thinking. For several years, this has been the paradigm in learning histories. In fact, all key articles of the first decade of this century were based on it. It was also the paradigm from which we started here in Groningen in 2004. To our pleasure, we soon discovered how well it worked, but that success also saddled us with new questions. In our view, the theory of retrieving mental models from stories describes pretty well what learning historians do, but it does not completely explain why historical narratives can change people's mental models, and through that the organization as a whole. As you may know from recent history, and I mean very recent history, Narratives are tricky things. They frame reality in a particular way. Indeed, sometimes so particular that reality disappears. For learning historians, the crucial problem is therefore, how do we get from the particular narratives to a collective narrative which effectively changes the entire organization without losing sight of reality? Moreover, unlike George Roth and Art Kleiner, we could not explore and test the mental models in special learning labs, which made the very concept of mental models very difficult to handle for us. As a result, as we soon discovered, we did not have good criteria to decide which narratives to include in the learning history and which not. If you keep too close to the stories of the organization, the learning history becomes, so to speak, too flat. But if you take too much distance from the stories, the people in the organizations will not be able to recognize themselves in your story. But even more difficult, we found the problem of inventing the right questions for the organization. For how can you know which question will effectively contribute to organizational learning? On this point, we took up the challenge by applying our own theories of history. For reasons of time, I will not give an account of all the steps we made in this, for it was a long journey guided by trial and error. But here are the main three steps. I will briefly explain the first two steps and concentrate on the third. So from the narrativist theory of history, and in particular Frank Ankersmit, we took the notion that historians can create order in the chaos of facts because they have the benefit of hindsight. Unlike the actors in the past, historians can know the outcomes of their actions. This knowledge enables them to distinguish between intentions and unintended outcomes. The distinction between intentions and outcomes forms the basis of the plot of a historical narrative. Part of the learning effect of the narratives lies here. The plot provides the reader with both the actor's perspective and the overall perspective, thus offering an explanation of how things came about in a way that goes beyond that of the actors. To understand the actor's perspectives, we drew heavily on Collingwood's logic of question and answer, according to which the meaning of an answer can only be found by reconstructing the question to which it was meant as an answer. You can see it here. If you say that's the academy building, that can be an answer to different questions, each with its own presupposition. To understand this relationship means to investigate the presuppositions on which both questions and answers are based, and ultimately the absolute presuppositions on which all questions and answers relating to a subject are based. In the learning histories practice, this theory works pretty much like Shine's ladders of inference. Find the basic assumption behind or below the description of events. In the presentation of learning history, it leads to the corollary that the story must lead the organization to ask the right questions. And these are the questions which challenge an organization's absolute presuppositions. This changed our view of the function of learning histories. Their conclusion should not end a story, but raise further questions. Combining narrativism and hermeneutics gave us a first principle, which we call the principle of maximum empathy and maximum distance. Learning historians should try to understand each individual as well as they can, but when it comes to understand the organization, they should keep maximum distance. This is as far as we got about 2010, but we still felt that we had not closed the gap between individual and collective learning enough. The second step came when Frank retired and Jaap den Hollander took his place. Jaap, who is sitting here, is one of the best experts on systems theory in this country and also one of the best teachers this university has ever seen. This is proven by the fact that he manages to make even Niklas Luhmann's systems theory understandable. From Luhmann, we took the notion that all observation involves making distinctions, of which only one side is marked. From this it follows that all observation necessarily involves blind spots. To detect the blind spots involves a second order observation, that is, an observation of an observation. This theory enabled us to view the learning historian as a second order observer, who is particularly apt to retrieve the blind spots not only in individuals, but also in organizations as a whole. Accordingly, the learning history retrieves and expounds the blind spots of an organization as a whole in order to make it see again. This is roughly as far as we got about 2012, when Dirk-Jan Wolfram replaced Jaap den Holland. With his arrival, another dimension was added to our researches. As professor in the history of governance and politics, he shifted the attention to the broader political and social context of the organizations we were researching. This broader dimension forced us to rethink the relationship between systemic and historical thinking again, because focusing on non-profit organizations, we found continuous references to political and social systems. Accordingly, the problem for us was to develop a view of the interrelationship between all these systems, starting from the viewpoint of the people working in the organizations. In other words, the problem is to connect the level of individual intentions and actions to the level of organizations as systems, interrelated to even larger social and political systems. In my view, this is also the problem that dominates the recent literature about learning histories. And if I'm not mistaken, our colleagues try to solve it by somehow merging the action research paradigm with systems thinking. I think that is the most promising, but also a most challenging approach, and I look forward to hearing their views today and tomorrow. In the meantime, I will expound the Groningen approach, which focuses on merging hermeneutics and systems thinking. Our starting point are the ideas of Wolfgang Schneider, a German sociologist, who argues that hermeneutics can be used as a method for system thinking. This is a quite controversial thesis, because normally the two approaches are held apart. Schneider tries to bridge this gap by merging Collingwood's logic of question and answer to Luhmann's notion of the reduction of complexity. His key proposition is that both individual actions and social systems can be viewed in terms of questions and answers. This is the linking pin, the notion of question and answer, both for organizations and for individual actions. The connection between the individual actions and the system is provided by what he calls a Stufenleiter, a step ladder of interrelated question and answer sequences. Methodologically, this theory entails that learning historians can build up the ladder from either way, or they look at the central problem of an organization and explore how this is translated to individual questions and answers, or they start from the level of individual questions and answers to understand the problem of the organization as a whole. But whatever direction they take, the goal is to reach a perspective which shows how all questions and answers are intrinsically connected. In order to show how this works, let me give an example of a small town in the north of Holland that had been ordered by the state to build a refugee hostel close to the city. Soon there was a lot of resistance against this, and at a certain point, the civil servants who were involved in the building of the hostel were threatened. In our learning history for the civil servants, we traced all of their steps from their intentions at the start of the project, the decisions they had made, the alternatives they had discarded, and the way they had communicated their plan to the citizens, and the ways they had dealt with the protests. The learning history presented all the decisions, including the alternatives they had not chosen, in one coherent story from which emerged the picture of an organization consisting not so much of civil servants carrying out a given task, but of people committed to a cause of helping refugees. And this commitment became manifest on the evening we presented the learning history. We had distributed it before, and all people involved had read it. Soon it became clear that they were greatly impressed by the story. They said, "We recognize all the things mentioned. These are the facts, but we have never seen it in this way before." And at the moment supreme. I asked, okay, but when you look back at all the resistance from the town, why did you continue to build a hostel? One civil servant stood up, and I will never forget his answer. And he said, because we don't let people down outside in the rain. A big silence set in. Everyone present realized that this had been the guiding principle of their organization. Not so much the formal organization, but the informal organization. And at that moment, the civil servants truly learned because they realized that this guiding principle had focused their attention on the refugees, but at the same time, it had blinded them for the effects a hostel would have on the citizens of their own town. Looking back, they realized that by assuming that the citizens of the town shared their ideals of helping the refugees, they had not paid enough attention to properly communicating about the project. As they admitted, communication to the citizens had been their blind spot. By the way, all this did not take place in 2016, but in 1998, almost 20 years ago. I took this example because it is as actual now as it was then. And I took it because it explains why civil servants in the same situation now can still learn from their colleagues then. And I took it because being the grandson of a Hungarian refugee, I personally learned much from it. All this shows how learning histories can contribute to sustainable societies. By historically addressing the people's questions from the context of the problems of organizations, learning histories can contribute to retrieving the guiding ideas of our societies. They can show us the ideals we live for and the principles we live by. Learning histories can help to reflect on the past in order to build a sustainable future. And this future is present here in this living past of this beautiful room. We see the future here on the front rows, where the founding fathers and mothers of learning histories are gathered. But above all, we see the future behind them, where the students are sitting. And it is to the students that we dedicate this conference. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Rick. It works. Thank you. Well, perhaps you could resume position because we have some time, about 15 minutes for questions and answers. I emphasize questions. So I would like to take questions now. Let's see who is having a question. I see Kleiner here. Well, for starters, please.
Rick. The microphone.
Microphone, sorry.
Rick, what happened next at the refugee camp?
What happened next? Well, when we did learning history, it was already 8 years before that. What happened was that several civil servants left the organization because they could not longer stand the resistance. And the people who, two of the political responsible, they also left. So when we were sitting there 8 years after that event, the atmosphere was pretty tense. In the end, they built a hostel, and the resistance continued. But after a while, it withered away, so to speak. But 8 years after it was still very emotional to speak about this. And I think emotions are very important when we do learning histories, because when you are interviewing people, you immediately, that comes through in the story, so you have to deal with that. And at the same time, when you keep some distance to it, not get totally involved with their stories. Is that an answer to your question? Okay, thank you.
One might add that in 2016 there were serious political problems in the Netherlands with protests against huge refugee camps, and one might wish that one had learned from this learning history. Okay, questions? Another question? Yes.
While we're still on the refugee subject, would it have been interesting to have included the citizens in the learning history exercise as well?
That's a good question. In the beginning, we decided that it would be a learning history only for the civil servants, so for the organizations, because our starting point is always the organization. But in later phases, you can, of course, also interview the people in the town, which we did, for example, in the Groningen project, which goes from the municipality all to the citizens in the town. But that's a decision which depends on time and on the goal of the learning history. Maybe for this refugee problem, it would be very good to involve citizens as well to see what it all means. Yeah.
There's a question over here.
You talked about circular questioning as a way that you do it here. What does that look like? What does that entail?
Well, we discovered it in the literature about systemic theory, and they use it. They took it from Italian systems psychologists, and the idea is that you when you start, for example, interviewing you, I would ask you how you think that your actions are perceived by Dirk Jan Wolfgang, for example. And then I would ask him in an interview how he perceives your actions, etc., etc. So that around a certain problem, you make these circles. And this gives you, we discovered that this gives you very rich information about events, which you can use very well in the right-hand column, because there you get all these differences on the same event. Moreover, and that's quite shocking to some, that they discover what effects and unintended effects their remarks or actions may have. So that's why we use the circular questioning. Okay, maybe if people tell their names before they ask a question, that would help. Also for the circular question.
Thank you.
So I'm Christine Erlach and from Germany, and I'm working with experts, but my job is to ask silly questions to give them a possibility to find words for hidden knowledge. And maybe my question is silly as well, but it's important for me to, could you please pin down once more what is this the historic approach in on the other hand the systemic one, because I'm so from the systemic side that I'm not sure if I really understood the historic approach.
Yep.
Could you please repeat your differentiation?
Yeah, well, I will read the page again.
Yeah,
then.
No.
Well, this in very general terms, you can say that the systemic approach is universalizing, because you try to understand all the individual actions and texts in terms of the whole. And the historical approach is, well, the other way around. The goal is to individualize, to understand the specific texts and actions in general terms. And the trick is how to combine them, because as learning historians, we have always to begin deep down in the valley. We don't have an idea or a clear idea of the system. Moreover, the formal definition of the system can misguide you. That is also shown in the example. The organization we discovered, so to speak, was the informal organization of civil servants who tried to help the refugees. That was also part of their formal task. But the way they interpreted it was based on their absolute presupposition that they should help people. Another part of the historical approach is that we always go back in time as much as we can. For example, in the Groningen research, we go back 40 years. And our experience is that the farther back you go, the richer your history becomes, because you have all these layers of what we call a living past, which is still present but hidden in those layers. You get that, you can retrieve that, and that's important. For example, the tax administration was established in 1806. It has an enormous tradition of doing things, and maybe it doesn't show when you enter a tax administration office. It does not immediately show, but the more you go into it, you see that all these traditions are still there. The military is the same. Universities are mountains of living past. So, but it raises a very interesting question also for the audience and for people who are doing writing learning histories. How far back should you go? Because to many of my colleagues, 200 years is nothing. They laugh at it. 40 years is nothing. So how far back should you go? But even then, you can say that many of the absolute presuppositions, they go back a very long time in history, and they still are the foundations of how we think and how we act. Okay?
Okay, I see multiple fingers now. I'll come back to you, George. First, I go to you.
My name is Marteling de Boer. I'm a research lecturer from Stenen University Applied Sciences. Thank you for very interesting paper presentation. My question was triggered by your story about the refugee camp. And I was wondering, looking into the future and a sustainable society, what should have been done in order to have this story, awareness from your stories, continue so that the problems that we focused last year, or that we met last year, wouldn't have happened?
Mm-hmm.
Because isn't that one of the goals of our stories?
Essential question.
Yeah. Yes, that's of course the goal of our stories, to let the people reflect on what they have done, but not just for that. You have to go, you have to also look at the future. That's what they did in the session, so they realized that they would never do it in that way, because they realized that they had a blind spot for communication. Accordingly, they changed their communication methods after. It's also part to Art's Kleiner's question. What you see now in 2016, well, they have not read our learning history, but you see that there is a tendency to take the previous flood of refugees and what happened then very seriously and to change the policies. But in my view, you can enhance that process by consciously writing those histories for organizations so that it really gets ingrained into the organizations. Now it is that people from above, they say, well, we have to do it differently from 1998, and it's imposed on organizations. But if you really want it to work, then learning histories can do a very good job, that all the participants learn from it. So, for the future, yeah.
I'm Arif Steensel, a historian here from Groningen. Thank you, Rick, for explaining what learning histories actually entails. You described the method in a very neutral way, but of course the use of the method is not so clear. You can use it for different ends. So in your example, you actually analyze the civil servants who actually try to set up a refugee hostel. But of course, you could also have helped the citizens who organize themselves against the refugee hostel. So my question is actually, how should we understand a sustainable society? So when should we use this method and when shouldn't we use it?
Well, to begin with the last question, in case of emergency, don't use it. There's no time. You really need time. But if you want to be prepared for cases of emergency, then do it, because it can prevent a lot of trouble if you do it in the right time. So imagine that these civil servants had done this before 1998. Maybe they would have reacted differently. And the first part of your question, well, how can you use it? That's one of the very interesting things in learning history, is that before you start, you never know exactly how you will use it. You have the method, you have the approach, you know somehow how to do it, but it depends very much on what organization you approach, what the central problem is as formulated by the organization, and how we translate it into a research question. Here is an interesting dialogue always going on, that the organization has a certain problem, we have to translate it. One of the pitfalls here is that organizations, well, they have a view of their problems, but that may not be the right view. We have to dig deeper in order to understand what is below the problems, so to speak. And yes, from that, you can decide whether to involve citizens, yes or no. We could also have written a learning history for the citizens, who are also an organization. So, but that depends on time and research questions.
Thank you. George and Art want to win.
I think, so Art Kleiner, I think that's a really important question. And underneath it is a fundamental question about whether awareness of multiple perspectives leads to progress and enlightenment, or whether and whether there, you know, it's really a question about the synthesis of multiple points of view. If you believe that the simple act of becoming more aware of how different people are thinking in a complex situation and what has brought them to their points of view and why response to each other is going to lead, you know, how they are going to respond to each other as based on the grounds of what has brought them to their various points of view. And being made and if you believe that being made aware of these differences in a more explicit way is going to lead to greater, you know, sort of collective enlightenment, for lack of a better word, then intrinsically the method will get you better results. If you believe that, you know, if you're more relativist, if you believe that, you know, there isn't necessarily a synthesis out there, that reality is a little bit more arbitrary, then learning histories are going to be a difficult means. You're going to assume that they're value driven by the biases of whoever is conducting the interviews and whoever is chosen for the interviews. So it really has to do with whether you believe that bias can be overcome or not. And I don't think anyone has settled that question.
Well.
George, you want to answer this?
George Roth. I was originally going to have my hand up to follow on the question that Christina asked, but I also want to raise a topic for our conference, which really comes from the question that we've just had and from Rick's presentation. So far, I think we have to be very careful to distinguish the creation of the learning history for the organization that we've written it about versus the creation and use of the learning history in the question that was asked for sustainable societies. So what could we have learned in 2016 from what happened in 1998 and what was written, and how, and this is, I think, valuable for a simulation that we run in our minds, could we have used the learning history with a group of people in a locality that was facing a crisis in 2016 with refugees to say, this happened in the past. As we come together to organize ourselves, we will read this and we'll take a half a day for a discussion. Mm-hmm. And will people see their perspectives in this in such a way that enlightens them? And that, I think, is what art is asking. The question is, how do we get from an awareness of perspectives to what I would say would be a shared understanding, which might guide our future action? Mm-hmm. And that connects into something I hadn't thought about until last night, which was, I'll say it kindly, Rick's critique of presencing. And the work that has attempted to go from reflection on the past into projection into the future, and using theory U that Otto Scharmer and Peter Senge have written about. But it has largely been separate from the learning history work. I think the question that was raised was the question of how does the learning history work connect to better action in the future? And not just local action with the organization, but the archetype of action and thinking and perspectives that repeat themselves again and again, not just in time and history, but also in different locations. And how might we use the materials that we create, just like historians do in the classroom to teach children and societies about the past so that they can be effective citizens? How can we use learning histories to be effective citizens in the challenges that face us organizationally and systemically for sustainable societies? Mm-hmm. That's a big question.
That's a big question.
That's a theory, mm-hmm. not a question. Yeah.
Okay, well, how to deal with bias, you said, so far, nobody has found a method. If you mean a watertight method, I agree with you. But I think that part of the job, well, how to deal with bias and crooked stories, etc. I think that's the core business of historians. That's the critical method of historians consists of reading all the material and weighing evidence against one piece of evidence against the other in order to get the story. Or the stories, I must say, at least, straight, and then write your own story. And I think that's also part of the answer to you, why history? Because before you ever start doing all these difficult things about basic assumptions, and before you can ever discover whether, to answer your question, whether problems repeat themselves, the first thing you have to do is to get the facts right, that what you discover in the evidence, that at least you can defend what you have to what you discovered. So I think that's the core business of historians, and there's no end to it, because you can always write another story, which makes our discipline so interesting. You can always write another story, and that's exactly what you see in learning histories. Many times they say, well, that's not how we see it. But that's not our task to write a learning history for as you see it. On the contrary, if we write it as you see it, we have not done our job well enough. We must write a learning history in which you recognize all the facts, but from a completely different point of view, or in a different frame, as we say it nowadays. But then to your question, George, how can they be used in time? Yes, I think that a learning history, as we wrote back in, it was 2007, I think, if that would have been published more broadly, it could have been used by civil servants now in the same, almost the same position. It depends, of course, on how you define the same. And that's an interesting philosophical question, to what extent you can compare situations. Historians are very keen on this, because they say you can never compare earlier periods or early events with later. But the answer is, well, depends on your point of view, whether you see the identities, yes or no. A good example of how they were actually used are the learning histories we wrote for the tax administration, which are used in their educational program. As real life cases. And I know from the the organizers of the training program in Utrecht that the upcoming inspectors, etc., in the tax administration, they like the stories, because they say, yes, that's real life. That's not invented. That's how we see our jobs. So there they actually use the learning histories in the material. But I also want to raise a topic for this conference. I think that as I said, learning historians, they are more keen on doing research than on publishing it. And maybe we should think about publishing more. If we so strongly believe that it helps, we should also publish more on this. Maybe that will help to create sustainable societies.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much, Rick. Okay.